Hello, everyone. Sorry that I've been away for a little bit. For those who saw my brief announcement video from last week, you know why, but those who didn't see the video, well, Meg and I, we have a cat, and we wanted to give him some time to adjust to us before I started doing the web show again. He's gotten quite used to us, which is really good. He's, somewhere in the house right now. He was getting into a bit of mischief earlier, but he might pop back in here in a bit. I don't know if you'll see him in the video or not, but if you do, you do. If you don't, you don't. Right, so today's story. It's actually a good story, and I'm assuming you guys already know that it's going to be an Eddy story. The story is called Me, Myself, and Ed. The author is Zamper Samba. I'm not going to be reading the story out loud because it's way too long. It's over 18,000 words. So, I'll read the summary for you. Part 10, the epilogue in, picks up where the episode 3 squares and Ed, where they all end up grounded, left off. Ed's 3 days are up, but his friends still have a few to go. What's a lone Ed boy to do? And what are Ed and Eddie up to in the meantime? So, it's rated K. It's in English. It's humor. 10 chapters. Over 18,000 words. 69 reviews. 72 faves. 13 follows. And it was published back in October of 2002. And was updated in November of 2002. So this is a very old story. Very old. It's over 20 years old. Bloody hell. Ugh. Damn, 20 years old. You don't realise how long ago 2002 was until you think about it. Right. So, the first chapter. Well, I'm not going to break it down by chapters because you really can't. Some of the events will stretch from chapter to chapter. So, you know, we'll just briefly talk about what's going on with Eddy and Ed. And then we'll talk about Double D, because the story primarily focuses on Double D. So, Eddy and Ed are still grounded, where Double D is out of his grounding. They're grounded for the entire week. And they're both confined to their bedrooms. Now, you know, it's not like they can leave their rooms or anything. Apparently, they are to stay in their room for the entire duration of their grounding. Even to eat food. Which kind of implies to me that it's like, so are they not even allowed to leave to use the loo? Are they given like a bucket to use? It's a bit ridiculous. Especially when we're talking about Eddy. Eddy is described to be locked up in practically Alcatraz. Like everything's balled up, everything's chained up. It's utterly ridiculous. And Ed, in the meanwhile, he has nothing in his room. The thing is, his bratty sister Sarah, I'm assuming she was the one that got him grounded to begin with. I think that's how it goes in the show, that she's the one that keeps getting him into trouble because she's a bloody brat. And not just that, but when he tries to entertain himself in his own room, she puts up a fuss, and then his parents come and take away the offending item. Like, it's to a point that he can't even sing. Yes, Sarah's not a very likable character. Now, I would compare to my childhood, but I already know that my childhood was, well, not a normal childhood. All I'll say about my childhood was that my parents are very spare the rod, spoil the child. Although that only seemed to apply to me and not my brothers. So we'll go by Meg's childhood from what she told me. I mean, she told me that there was times that her and her sister were confined to their room, but it wasn't like they weren't allowed to leave their room at all. It was like a timeout type of thing. And other means of punishment is, you know, no television for a week or no Game Boy for a week, you know, stuff like that. Not this. You're not allowed to leave your room. You're not allowed to have anything in your room. We have to give you your meals, which will just encourage ants and whatnot. But we're going to give you your meals in your room because you're not allowed to leave your room at all. Yes, a bit over the top. But that's what's practically going on with Eddy and Ed. But with Double D, which was what this story focuses on, it pretty much is about him interacting with the other cul-de-sac children and everything going awry. So the first child he interacts with is Rolf, who has a farm. So he decides to help Rolf on his farm. And he does something offending, unintentionally offending, mind you, but something offending. And Rolf gets very furious and is like, you're banished, go away, I don't want you near my animals, get away. So, Ed Double D, I should say. They're all Eds. We'll just call him Double D. He's a smart one, by the way. He then comes across, involuntarily, Sarah, who's Ed's sister, as I mentioned before, and Jimmy. And they decide that they want Double D to be part of their tea party. Now, it's obvious that Sarah has a crush on Double D, and that Jimmy has a crush on Sarah. And because Jimmy has a crush on Sarah, and he sees that Double D has attracted Sarah's attention, he's not very happy about this. So when Sarah goes off for a little bit, Jimmy is like threatening Double D. And then when Sarah comes back, he's pretending to be all sweet and innocent, even though he's not. So they decide that they want to give Double D a makeover, and Double D's having none of it, and he manages to escape from them. Then he gets himself into even more trouble with the Kanker sisters. These three girls each have a thing for each of the Eds. So they want to know where the other Eds are. He's trying to get them away from him. So he tricks them into going to the river, the lake, saying that they're swimming in the lake. And then he uses one of his gadgets to trap them in a net. And he escapes that way. So after that, he comes across Naz, who's a girl that he kind of has a thing for. And when she discovers that he's the only Ed about in the neighborhood because the other two Eds are still grounded, she takes pity on him and has him come and hang out with her in her house. And they decide to watch some television, which is all nice and simple and, you know, innocent. It's reality TV, though. And because Ed, or Double D, I should say, he's smart and whatnot, and, you know, reality TV does not go well with him because he sees all the inconsistencies and the illogicalness of it all. He can't help himself, and he starts criticizing the television show to the point that Naz gets super, super angry with him, goes off on him, and then she feels bad about going off on him, but kicks him out of the house regardless. So, yes, Double D is kicking himself because he knew it was his own fault that she got angry. It was a deal that he just could not control himself. But around the time that he exited her house, Kevin, the neighborhood bully, happened to see him leaving Naz's house, and Kevin has a thing for Naz. So he's trying to get Double D to spill the beans about how he got into Naz's house. And, you know, Double D's telling him the truth. He's like, she took pity on me because the other two Eds are not around. Kevin doesn't believe him. And the next thing Double D knows is that he's tied upside down to Jungle Gym balls. So then he comes across, well, he doesn't really come across Johnny. Johnny comes across him, Johnny, with his plank. Johnny has a plank of wood that he's friends with. It has a face drawn on it and everything. For those who've seen Ed, and Eddy, you know who Plank is. So anyway, he's trying to, you know, get out of being tied up at the Jungle Gym bars. And Johnny, being as oblivious as he is, wants to play tag with Double D. And so they do play tag. This gets Double D free from his restraints. But Johnny can't take a hint, and he just keeps going off and off and off and keeps, like, talking super fast, and it gets to a point that Double D just screams and runs off. So at this point, Double D has interacted with all of the cul-de-sac children, and he's like, you know what, I'm going to get the other Eds free from their grounding. Meanwhile, I don't think I told you about what happened with Sarah and Jimmy. I mean, I think I went into that a little bit, but with him escaping from them for their tea party, Sarah gets in trouble from her parents, or with her parents, because when she was doing her little tea party, she had taken dishes from the house, and the parents were mad about this because she didn't ask permission. So instead of just telling her don't do it again, they decide to ground her. Her parents are very ground happy, I've noticed. Though I don't feel bad for her, because she immediately tries to blame Ed, who couldn't possibly do it because, you know, he's confined to his barren room, no thanks to her. And thankfully, the parents have enough common sense to not believe her this time around, so she gets grounded. So this is where we go from Ed's point of view. Ed is obviously super bored because he has absolutely nothing in his room, and he's resentful that his sister keeps getting him into trouble. But then he hears Jimmy crying about Sarah being gone. And then Ed gets it in his head. It's like, oh no, Sarah was taken by the spaghetti noodle people. Yes, he has a very wild imagination. So he's trying to prepare himself for fighting the spaghetti noodle people. And he's, like, interrogating Jimmy about, you know, what happened to Sarah, because he thinks that the spaghetti people and Jimmy were in cahoots with each other. Meanwhile, back to Eddy, his mother brings him food. And Double D uses this opportunity to sneak into the room. Somehow, the mother does not notice this other child, random child in the house, sneaking into her grounded son's bedroom. So, because he's in there with Eddy, they manage to get free. And now, Eddy is roaming the neighborhood with Ed, and he's no longer grounded. I mean, he's grounded, but he's finally escaped his room. So they are trying to come and find the other Ed to get him out of his grounding. And what happens is that Eddy and Double D come across the Kanker girls again. And they're obviously not very happy about the trick that Double D played on them. So now they're chasing after those two Eds. The Eds are trying to deliberately have the Kanker girls follow them because they know about, you know, Ed being super strong, and they figure it's like, oh, well, maybe we can get Ed to drop his house on them. And that's exactly what happened. He was out of his house. He was holding it because he was trying to find the spaghetti noodle people. And he comes across the other two Eds and the Kanker girls, so he drops the house on the Kanker girls. And then Sarah hangs her head out of the window and starts screaming at Ed because he's supposed to be grounded. So Ed, at first, is happy that his sister is alive, and then he realizes, oh no, she's alive, and I'm outside of my room, which I'm not supposed to be because I'm grounded. So the story pretty much ends where it's implied that all three of them are grounded again. Double D decides that even though his parents will probably only ground him for a few days, he'll stay in his room until the other two Eds are free from their grounding, so then that way they can all be free around the same time. What's fair is fair. And that's pretty much how the story ends. I probably didn't do it justice with my summarized review of it, but, you know, it's a pretty good story. It just plays out like a normal episode. If you want to read it in full detail, by all means, go right ahead. I always provide the links to the stories in the description and whatnot. But yes, it was refreshing to read a good story. I already know that the next story I'm doing is not going to be good. But if I'm lucky, maybe it'll be too long to read on the series and I can just do a summarized review of that, but time will tell. Right, well, thank you all for watching today's episode. If you liked it, please be sure to leave a like and leave a comment. And if you haven't subscribed yet, please do. I would greatly appreciate it. I'll see you on the next episode. Until then, cheerio. Right, this is a post-review add-on. This is Leo. Hello, Leo. Aren't you sweet? Yes, I made the mistake of going and changing out of the FanFic Critic outfit and opening that door, and he decided, I'm going to go inside of it. And now he's out of the room. And now he wants treats. Yes. Even though you just had treats not that long ago. Right. Well, yes, he's a very sweet cat. He is a Maine Coon tabby mix. And the only reason why I know he has tabby in him is because he has that telltale M on his head. Yes. Isn't that right? Very nice cat. He's adapted quite nicely to us. Yes. Well, you know what? After I get dressed, we'll go down and we'll see what Meg's doing. How about that? Okay, that's where he is. He's probably going to go down and get Meg to give him snuggies or try to trick her into giving him treats. Because that's what cats do. They like to manipulate. Right, well, see you all in the next episode. Till then, cheerio!